My name is Isabel Zumtobel. We are here in our new Light Forum today, and I have the great pleasure of introducing the talented engineer and architect, Professor Werner Sobeck, who created and designed our most recent annual report. This edition focuses on a very important topic, which is the environment, its sustainability, and our responsibility. We reminisce on our previous collection of annual reports and proudly present you the last one. Mr. Sobeck's 17th thesis illustrates that a real sustainable change is a deep necessity for our planet and civilization. Mr. Sobeck, we are all ears and we are looking forward to your presentation. The stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Zumtobel, for your kind introduction. And thank you so much for inviting me to design the annual business report of the Zumtobel Group 2019. A business report is always something about the past. It is describing the numbers and the successes and the outcome of the company. And designing the business report 2019 for me was to also add an aspect of the future. That means also to add architectural aspects to it, since architecture, the built environment in its totality, is one of the dominant factors when we think about and when we discuss about global warming, shortcoming of resources, filling the seas with waste, etc., etc. Architecture is always an anticipation of the future. And to talk about the future in a professional way necessitates that we find the basis from where we start, that we talk about where are we nowadays, where do we want to go to, what are the objectives of mankind, and what are the boundary conditions we have to obey or we have to fulfill. And as a technique, which I'm using since many, many years, showing from a big distance onto the planet, in order to understand, like looking on the hill of ants, what is going on there. And this gives you a very discrete understanding of the entity of the functions which happen there down at the planet. But there's also the absolute need to be in the middle of the people and to understand and try to understand their behavior and try to understand why they act as they act. So it is this, and I'm looking at Joseph Beuys, the famous German artist who died so early, already with 65, who always said, an artist has to stand aside from the society in order to understand the very discrete happenings which are going on there, but he also has to be a member of the society in order to understand the feelings of the people. And this is how I act as an architect, and this is how I also act as a scientist. So it is about future, the formulation of objectives, the definition of the boundary conditions, and the becoming aware of where are we. And if we look in nowadays TV news and we see the big fires in California, we become a little bit anxious. And many people think about California is far away. It is a tragedy, but it might not hit me because I'm living in another spot on this planet. But there is a negative feeling and there's a feeling of uncertainty with the people. Is this something which might happen next year, in the next decades, also with us? And there is the realization that the population is growing relatively fast. Nobody knows the precise numbers, but we all know the headlines in the newspapers, in the media, and obviously we are growing to up to 9 or 10 billion people in the year 2050, but nobody really has a picture what that means. We look at the big cities, at the metropolis cities, And we realized there are 10 to 20 million people living in one big agglomeration of buildings with an incredible infrastructure, but nobody really understands how does this infrastructure work and how it is going to work if the cities grow further. And from time to time we read and we hear and we see about the shortening of materials. We always thought there is plenty of sand on the planet. Why do we negotiate the cost of sand? And now we have to realize there isn't enough sand. At least there is not enough sand to make concrete out of it. We have the deserts. We have these waste areas filled up with sand. But the desert sand cannot be used to produce concrete, to make concrete out of it. So we read about the shortcoming of copper, of tin and zinc. And we have a feeling that there might come up something on the horizon we are incapable to solve. And we look at pictures like this and ask ourselves, does this really make sense to live this way, to live in the center of the crossing of a multi-lane road, in the dust and in the smog and in the loudness of this? And we lean back and say, is this the objective we really want to follow, or is this something which just happened and nobody wanted it to happen? It was never planned the way it turned out. And we read about emissions. And if we look at a chimney like this, where the smog comes out of it in millions of cubic meters per day, we of course feel this is something I do not want to breathe in. But we learn about CO2 and the limitation of the CO2 emissions in order to limit the global warming to certain degrees. And we don't understand what it really means, because CO2 has the crucial effect that it is invisible and it does not smell. If CO2 would be, let's say, dark red and would stink, everyone immediately would stop emitting this material. But since it is gaseous waste, which nobody can realize, we don't care about it. It is an abstract number. And then, misleaded by certain people, we talk about the necessity to be energy efficient. Everyone wants to be energy efficient. I say, why? As one of the typical scientific strategies in order to really precisely lay the ground, lay the basis, realizing where are we as the starting point of our path. Since the sun, alone the sun, is radiating 10,000 times more energy onto our planet than the human beings need for all their activities, there's obviously no energy problem as such. The problem is that we base all our living on an energy which is produced, not the right word, but which is produced by burning fossil materials. And the burning of those materials, this is the negative effect. If we already in the first industrial revolution would have started to base our energy supply on other sources, we would not have a global warming problem. So where are we? This is our planet in the middle of nowhere. And if we look at the hydrogen atom, and we look at the atom core, and we imagine that the core of the atom is like a football, like a soccer ball, then one of the electrons is out there 200 meters away with the size of a tennis ball. And in between there is emptiness. And here, in the space, in between the planets and the suns, there is nothing else than emptiness. And we are sitting on one of those planets, on one of those spaceships, and we cruise through space with a speed of 100,000 kilometers per hour, an unbelievable speed, and nobody knows where we come from, and nobody talks about where we want to go to. But since the influence of human behavior on our planet is endangering the functionality of the atmosphere and of our surroundings, of the so-called critical, sphere. We have to talk about future, and this is why I'm so thankful that I have been invited to talk about future in a business report. And we have to commonly define objectives we are going to reach out for. Now, talking about future, very often amongst people is considered to be blah blah, visionary blah blah, and allows to make statements of any kind. But I'm referring to the famous philosopher Ernst Bloch, who is his entire life long was talking about future. He called that das Prinzip Hoffnung. And Hoffnung not as hope as such, hoping for the arrival of something which might never arrive. Hope in the sense of scientifically, precisely defining the path to a common future. So he called it a docta spes, developing future as a scientific maneuver. And he based, as I do, his statements always on these pillars, saying, before we start, we have to be conscious and we have to understand where are we. We have to precisely define the facts, and we have to precisely define the interaction between those facts. By the way, defining the facts and the interactions between the facts is the basis of any science, and it is also the basis of any democracy. And the next phase is, what are the boundary conditions? And finally, where do we want to go to? Which is this societal and inter-societal contract agreement we have to reach out for so that we can commonly pass the way to this future. And I took the chance to formulate 17 theses in the traditional sense, as the scientists in Central Europe already in the 13th and 14th hundred did when they had to defend their doctoral dissertation. Since there was no printing media and there was no internet, of course, at those times, they just nailed the principal statements of the outcome of their thesis onto the doors of the lecture hall. And every professor intending to attend this defense, he could read what it is going about. So there's a long tradition in formulating a thesis. And a thesis is a theoretical formulation, statement, which might be 100% true, which might be 80% true, and a little bit of subjective woven in. It is something to start a discussion. And I formulated those 17 theses, you might see them behind me, which are of equal importance and which might be surprising to people because they never thought about it or they never heard about it. But these 17 theses are what I called the manifestation of the facts and the interrelation between the facts, focused on the building environment. I'm not talking about things outside building, even if some of the theses are true also for non-architectural applications. The thesis number 17 is one of the most important ones. It's the conclusio of my thoughts. It means natura mensura est. It is a Latin expression and means the nature is the topic we have to obey. In former times, it was Deus mensur est, God is the only one. And then people detected after the Renaissance that it might be the human being who is most important on the planet, and they called that Homo mensura est. Now, since this Homo, female and male, the human beings are endangering our surroundings in a dramatic way, we have to realize that the planet itself will always survive, even if the global warming is 10 degrees. The human beings will not. So we have to save nature as a protecting element, as an enabler of our future life. Natura mensura ist. So this is the objective then, to create a built environment which is emission free, which consumes only a little of resources, which is 100% recyclable, of course, which is flooded with light, and where everyone wants to live. Cities which are quiet, and where you can breathe deeply. Another interesting, in my thought, interesting statement is thesis number 13, which means architecture is nothing else than the project to create Heimat. Heimat as the thing surrounding the people, physical as well as psychological Heimat or embeddement. And in fact, this is a quote from Ernst Bloch II, who stated this in his main work, Das Prinzip Hoffnung. There's nothing else. And of course, architecture might be split up into two sections. The one is the architecture as art, taught at the Ecole des Beaux-Arts, and the other part is architecture and its technical aspect taught at the Ecole Polytechnique. And of course, the two belong together like a yin and yang, they two belong together, those two aspects like the sides of a coin. But in order to understand certain things more easily, we might be allowed to look on the one side or the other side of the coin. So creating Heimat in the future means to build with less material in a recyclable way, to build with recycled materials, to build in a totally another way. Because there are more and more people coming to the planet, and there are 6.3 billion people we declare to be member of developing countries. 80% of the people are members of developing countries. Means they do not have a fresh water supply, they do not have a wastewater or waste management systems, they do not have access to hospitals or to education, because they don't have the roads to reach out for the university, and they don't have the buildings to integrate a hospital in. So this is 80% of the population. And if we, being Christian people, state that everyone on the planet should have the same level of living in dignity, that this would necessitate an amount of material which in its production process would cause emissions in a gigantic size, which definitely would kill the planet. So we cannot provide a built home, a built Heimat for everyone on the planet. It simply does not work. It is a scientific, simple, and clear statement. But the people are there and we all love them, so we have to define and find other ways to provide them with what they need. And then trivial facts like that the population on the planet is growing by 2.6 people per second have to be thought through. If we give every one of those people an amount of material he needs to have access to education and to hospitals, to medical, etc., etc., then we would need to produce per second about 1,000 tons of building material. And the creation of that material and the forming these materials into building parts and forming a building out of those building parts would cause emissions of an unbelievable dimension. So there is the growth of the population, and this is totally okay, this is not negative, but the way, the answer from our side, architects, engineers, building industry, is not the right one. So we have to find those new answers, and we have to speed up in doing so. And this is why I formulated those 17 theses, hoping that everyone reads them, that everyone understands them, and that at least everyone takes care and uses of some of them. So this is a famous picture by Carl Sagan. It was taken out of a space cap. It's looking back to the Earth. This is the story of this hydrogen molecule and the emptiness. And we are on this planet riding through the space in a total emptiness. But this planet is our home. And as Pope Franciscus said, this is our common house. And this is what I add to the statement of the Pope, the house where no one can move out. So we have to take care of that house. And we have to provide a sensible future to allow all these people to live in dignity and happiness. Thank you.
On behalf of myself, Zumtobel, and all architecture and light lovers, we thank you, Mr. Sobeck, for such an inspiring and interesting presentation. We look forward to a luminous future ahead, full of captivating creations and exchanges. I personally look forward to these together with you all. A big thank you to our wonderful audience for their precious time and attention.